And yet, God seems to be playing hide and seek with the people on this planet. And so people say, well, I think I saw him. It's almost like the Elvis sightings, you know. I think that this is a tremendous indictment against the Christian system because of this peculiarity of one place in time.
You stated, and I want to be sure I understand your statement, you do not believe that a Jesus Christ, a man named Jesus Christ, lived on this earth. Is that correct, sir?
Yes.
Okay, now, can you help me understand how if a respected ancient historian named Josephus, whom I'm sure you're well aware of, specifically named a man that lived as Jesus, that was named Jesus Christ, and in several, you know, parts of his chronicles, I would imagine would be the word to use. How would you explain that, sir? And he had no, and
okay,
he did not believe in Christ.
That's a good question, but okay. We got time. Go ahead.
All right, that's a good question. First of all, keep in mind Josephus was born after Jesus is supposed to have died. And so he is not writing as an eyewitness. Now, I did not claim that eyewitness accounts are the only way that history can be written, but I want to make it clear that Josephus was not an eyewitness. He wrote late enough. He wrote at a time when the Gospels as we know them and a number of other Gospels that perhaps you don't know about were being written or had already been written. And so if those passages in Josephus were indeed written by Josephus, it would reflect nothing more than the fact that he was familiar with Christian propaganda, which already at that time, by the end of the first century, was quite widespread. And so actually, we would not be too surprised that, in fact, we would expect a lot more historians to mention something, at least just by report, from the evangelists that were sent out. As a matter of fact, however, you perhaps are aware that the passages in Josephus have been very strongly disputed as being Christian interpolations. The Christians were looking very hard to try to find other documentation, other proof. It was embarrassing that the only proof we had was in the Christian writings themselves. And so a very large number of ancient writers were altered, their writings were altered, and a number of things were actually created too, like the supposed correspondence between Seneca and Paul, to give a Stoic philosopher's blessing upon St. Paul. It is quite clear to me that the famous Testimonium Flavianum that we all talk about is indeed a Christian interpolation. It intrudes in the text of Josephus, and the idea that there was actually something written by Josephus about it, which was then made more Christian, won't stand because the whole thing intrudes in the text.
Jesus is mentioned twice by Josephus. This can't be explained away as a result of Josephus knowing only Christian sources, because in his Antiquity of the Jews, chapter 20, section 200, he gives information about Jesus, about the New Testament church not contained in the New Testament. He tells about the martyrdom of Jesus' brother James. He couldn't have gotten this out of the New Testament because James is still alive in the book of Acts. And therefore, he's obviously in contact with authentic historical information. It's not an interpolation either because it doesn't intrude. The other passage is connected with two incidences which are confirmed by Suetonius and Tacitus. Also, Josephus' stylistic traits are present in that passage. There was definitely, I think, a Jesus passage in Josephus, even if maybe it was subsequently dressed up a little bit by Christian copyists. R.T. France says it seems safe to assume Josephus spoke of Jesus' wisdom and teaching. Some people called him Messiah, and this, I think, is a consensus of scholarship.
Yes, Dr. Craig, in making reference to Solomon and the Second Commandment, you asserted that God is not material, that his being is immense and universal. How then could such a being be embodied in the person of Jesus Christ?
I think that the answer to the question is essentially the same way in which your immaterial self can be embodied in your physical body. I think of you as a combination of soul and body. I'm not a materialist and a determinist as Mr. Zindler is. I believe that human beings are units that have immaterial and physical portions. And in essence, what the incarnation says is that the mind or the soul of Jesus of Nazareth was the second person of the Trinity. And therefore, I don't see any more difficulty in having an incarnation of a divine mind than I do in seeing an incarnation, in our own case, of a human finite mind. The degree of infinitude of the mind doesn't have anything to do with physical size, like trying to, you know, get a huge physical being into a little shape, since precisely because God is immaterial, precisely because he's of the order of mind, he can be conjoined to a finite individual. So I don't see that as a difficulty, I guess.
Well, of course, I would say two things, at least. First of all, a number of other gods came into the bodies of other ancient people. At least we're supposed to believe that if we read our mythology books. And so that was not really all that unusual in Jesus. But the other thing is this idea of a disembodied mind. Now, from what we understand of neurophysiology, the process of mind is exactly that. It is a process. It's not a thing. It is a dynamic relationship which arises as a result of the electrochemical changes within the brain. And as long as the brain is operating in a certain way, within certain limits, we have consciousness, we have mentation, we have sensation. If you change that slightly with LSD molecules or alcohol molecules or low blood sugar and whatnot, you lose the mind. To think that the mind can survive the wreck of the brain and become disembodied is like thinking that 70 miles an hour can survive the wreck of a car.
Mr. Zindler, if reason and logic are convention or custom or arise by evolutionary chance out of the material universe, what is your reason for using reason for testing truth and reality? In other words, do you have a reason for your reason, or is it just your blind faith?
The ability to reason obviously was something that conferred selective advantage on various primate species. Indeed, the ability to reason and interpret sense data from the environment accurately has been part of the vertebrate evolutionary scheme itself. We find it perhaps most highly developed in the human species, but it certainly exists in our primate cousins as well. We use it because it works. We survive because this nervous system, which functions according to what we call conventionally now the rules of logic, because it works. It's a very pragmatic sort of thing. A species that evolved a logic or a nervous system that supported a logic that was not valid would not survive. It would be weeded out and replaced by a species that had a logic that worked better. And indeed, one of the famous philosophers of science, Karl Popper, has himself developed a theory of epistemology, of a theory of knowledge, in which he accounts for these meta-theories themselves in terms of evolution, that there is sort of a natural selection going on among logical systems, among philosophical systems. But actually, my answer is a very simple, pragmatic one. We use it because it works and allows us to survive.
I think that the question points to a deep incoherence in the atheist point of view. Namely, if our beliefs are formed simply as a result of the selective advantage, that means that our belief-forming mechanisms don't aim at truth, they aim at survival. So how do we know that everything that we believe is not really true, it's just something that helps you to survive? In other words, there's no reason to think that the evolutionary story itself is true rather than just something that has survival value. Worse than that, Mr. Zindler is a determinist, and therefore everything that he thinks is just like, say, having a toothache or a limb growing a leaf. There is no truth to it. It's just all determined. So how do you know that the views that you hold to aren't simply the result of physical stimuli rather than rationality? I think that atheism is ultimately destructive of rationality itself.
Okay. We're running over time. The vote is in, and so I'm going to curtail the rest of the questions and ask you if you would please.